What's up, guys? Welcome to the FloatCast. My name is Stephen Maxlow, and NAIC is over. It's done. It's finished. It's concluded. The COVID season has came and went, and it's over. If you qualified for the World Championships in London, congratulations and good luck. I'm proud of every person who did. I unfortunately did not, but it was a long shot to have qualified for that tournament anyway. But for today's video, we are going to be talking about my tournament report, how I did, how I felt about playing Palkia V-Star in a very large tournament like that, and just overall thoughts and feelings and recap the event, because it's the best tournament of the year for a reason, and I was really blessed to be back. And to all those who said hi to me while we were there, it meant a lot. It meant a lot to hear everybody say how much they loved the channel, the podcast, and all that. So thank you. It was honestly incredible. But that being said, we did play Palkia V-Star, as I alluded, and as this deck profile will show you. And but first, if you guys like FloatCast content, like this video. It means a lot. Subscribe to the FloatCast as always, and turn that bell on so you know my videos go live for you. If you guys do want to see gameplay of things like Palkia V-Star and other decks, like Dragapult? No, I'm just playing. You can head over to my Twitch channel, twitch.tv/FloatCast. I stream Tuesdays, Fridays, and Sundays. So Palkia V-Star, right? Why did I choose to play this deck? Well, it's a ton of fun. It's got a pretty high skill ceiling to it because of using Inteleon and Drizzt and stuff like that, and a ton of micro decisions because you get to just find whatever trainer card you need for whatever point of the game, and I enjoy the deck a lot. The subspace swell attack, 60 plus 20 more for each bench Pokemon on both sides of the field, is pretty good because it maxes out at 260 plus choice band or choice belt is 290, and then like some quick shooting Inteleons. You can get to one shot numbers if they fill the bench up, especially against Mew VMAX, which is super good. This list is a rendition. I think I cut three cards from Henry Brand's list. It was, or maybe just two. Yeah, Henry Brand's top eight list, I cut two cards. I cut the training court for Temple of Sinnoh because I thought it would be a lot better than it was for the tournament, especially against Blissey, but I never played against the Blissey. And then I cut, I don't remember exactly what I cut. Was it a water energy? No. I made a cut somewhere for the Starmie V because I thought the Starmie V would be really good against things like Blissey and Duraludon. And it was really good against Duraludon and Arceus V-Star, actually. But we'll get to that when I talk about my tournament report. But I cut those two things. I can't remember what the other thing I cut was. I don't remember. But, oh, Escape Rope. I cut an Escape Rope because this thing has free retreat, so if you need to use it, you can. And plus, you have scoop up nets to pivot and retreating costs because of the Star Portal ability lets you accelerate energies back onto the board, and plus Rod and stuff like that, and Melanie. So I didn't think we needed the Escape Rope, and honestly, it didn't come up at all where I needed it, kind of. But we'll get to that later. But yeah, so I don't really need to go too much into detail as exactly what this deck does, because you swing big with Origin Form Palkia V-Star, you can swing with Aqua Bullet if you need to, you can swing with Moonlight Shuriken as well, and also you do not have to forget, or you should not forget, that Hydro Break is a good attack too. Swinging for 200 damage is nothing to sleep on, and plus you don't have to wait a turn to accelerate to a you don't have to wait to evolve to a V-Star, right? You can attack, go first, attach energy, and then Melanie, and then the next turn you can attach, or you can just power one of these up real quick. So that's a really good attack and something to think about in the future too when you're playing this deck. You don't want to forget that. Hydro Break, good attack. All right. Other than that, like, oh, and then also you can swing the Starmie if they get a lot of energies on the field. So that's Palkia V-Star, right? So going into my day, right, let's talk about our matchups. You know, grab a cup of coffee. We'll be here a minute. So, I did not make day two. However, that is not why I'm making this video. I did want to talk about my list a little bit. And then some of the changes after I talk about my matchups I would have put in. But round one, we play against Mew VMAX. And my guy who I play, Grayson Stavenow, I think Rowan Stavenow's brother, could not flip heads to save his life. He ended up making day two, which was really cool. Could not flip heads, so we just steamrolled that matchup of just bossing Genesect over and over again. Which was, that was a week, a quick 2-0. So we got the dub there, you know, start off a little strong. And then round two, we played against Haru, a Japanese player. I don't want to butcher his name. So just Haru. He was the Limitless Online qualifier. He was playing Palkia as well, so it was a mirror match. But he had some cool techs in there. That game was actually really close. It was the first time I played against a Japanese player, and he understood a little bit of English, which was really helpful for me. It was actually kind of funny. We were playing the mirror match, and I would like pick up his Japanese cards and look at him, even though I don't like I had the same cards. I was just looking at him. He did play one Canceling Cologne, and I actually never seen Canceling Cologne in like person. I've seen it online, but like I couldn't remember exactly what it was. And then I saw the art, and I was like, "Oh yeah, that's Canceling Cologne." So he did play that. Never used it, but it was a really close match. Like game one, we got the dub, which was really nice. Game two was really super close, and then game three, I kind of bricked, and he ended up getting the win. So we're 1-1 going into round three. And we're up against Arceus and Talion, and we 2-0 Arceus and Talion, which felt really good. I can't remember that guy. Is that Zach Lucas? Something like that. Yeah, we 2-0'd the Arceus and Talion. So 2-1 going into the lunch break. I mean, that matchup's self-explanatory, right? You got to get a strong start, and then you can clean up with Starmie V if you need to. Which is, there's another Arceus and Talion where that played a huge factor in. So, that one was pretty quick. He was kind of dead drawing, and we just one from there. I thought Temple of Sinnoh would do a lot of work in that matchup, and it really, really doesn't, because you don't shut off abilities, right? They can just get the V-Star power to find the stadium, so I think Temple of Sinnoh is kind of useless. I mean, if you wanted it to be better, you'd have to play multiple copies, but if you're going to play multiple copies of a Disruption stadium, you would play Path to the Peak. So, yeah. This card was kind of useless all day. I'm not going to lie to you. But, it was mostly for Blissey. So, because you can stick stick this at the right turn against Blissey and Roxanne them, that way they can't use their lucky energies. You can, and you knock out that Blissey, you can really hammer them. So, yeah, that's for Blissey mostly. But I didn't play a single Blissey. All right, anyway, round four, we played against Flying Pikachu, Arceus, Crobat. I don't know if it was Azul 60 from Milwaukee, which ultimately was the 59 card, same as maybe 57 at the most, same as what he won NAIC with. But we tied that matchup. And honestly, we take those. Like, that was a rough matchup. I'm not going to lie to you. There's some cards in here I wish I played for that matchup. But to be honest with you, I did not test that matchup at all leading up into the week. So I didn't really, it wasn't even on my radar, which was very foolish of me. Like, as the round tournament went on, it was very foolish of me not to respect that matchup. But we tie that, so we're 3-1-1. No, yeah, no, 2-1-1 going into round five. And this is where Starmie finally puts in work, right? So we're 2-1-1. We go up against Arceus Duraludon, against a viewer of mine. So if you're watching this, sorry about the bricks. But, Starmie put into work. He was playing Arceus Duraludon. And game one, he accelerated some energies. And, you know, like Arceus does, it does the thing where it's like you go Trinity Nova accelerate to a Duraludon to set it up to just swing. Well, that puts six energy on board. And for Starmie V, you can Star Portal boss the plush choice belt, boss the Duraludon. If they don't have Big Charm on, I think he had a choice belt on his. So we boss the Duraludon, knock it out with the Starmie V, and then just go to town. Like, at that point, you get the three prizes. They can't really keep up with your setup. Like, I know you got to swing for like, they limit their bench size, so, like, Palkia is only doing 210 at max, but, like, you once you get the one shot on a Duraludon, you're putting a lot of pressure, because they have to take six prizes at that point, and you just... You're already at three, so you only got to take two knockouts. And we did that game one. Game two, he kind of had to do it again to accelerate. And but he was forced in a position. I don't know if it was to thin his hand down or, like, he was for or no, he needed a swing with it, get the Duraludon early. So he escape roped, and that allowed us to knock out the Duraludon without finding boss. We could afford to Melanie that turn. So we ended up 2-0-ing the Arceus Duraludon player. So now we're at 3-1-1, which we're feeling really good. Round six, we play against another Arceus Inteleon, and Starmie put in work there too, because, like I said, they have to Trinity Nova a lot, like, especially game one, right? Game one, they don't know that you play the Starmie V until it's too late, right? So, like, they go Trinity Nova onto two Arceus, you swing into Starmie V. What you do is you boss up the one on the bench, right? Because you want to leave the other one active because they have a big charm on it. They can't knock this out that early in the game. So it can stay for two turns to take two shots. Like, if you boss up the one with the three energies on it, this can't get one shot unless they have quick shooting set up, which he did not at the time. So we boss up the benched Arceus V that he accelerated to, then we hit it with the energy spiral to just knock it out. And then we hit the other one for like 150 or something. 160, 180, 180. No, I put 160 on it. I think I managed to get 160 on it. I can't remember how we did that. Or maybe it was 180. Yeah, it was 180. So we did 180, and then we cleaned up with a Moonlight Shuriken, like, KO'd the Arceus V-Star and a Drizzile on the bench. And then I had one prize left, and he had no setup and nothing. And that was the game. Like, Starmie V came in clutch for that one. So I was really liking the Starmie V tech, right? It was really good. And we're 4-1-1 at this point. I am buzzing. Absolutely buzzing. Three rounds left. We're 4-1-1. We got to win two of the next three. We're chilling. And we get to round seven. And we're at table 28. Pretty good. It was probably one of my best starts to a tournament to date. And we get paired against our homie, one of the good friends of the Flow T-Cast, Ethan Heggie. And my man is on an absolute mission to get his world's invite. He's got to get like top 64 or something like that to get his invite. And we were not stopping him. My man was playing Arceus Inteleon Beedrill with Flying Pikachu. This man was popping off. Like, it felt like I had the same start both games, right? And like, literally, it was at both board states, like, going into his turn again was literally the same setup, and there was nothing I could do about it. Like, I could not slow him down to save my life. I couldn't gust up any Flying Pikachus. I couldn't do anything, and it felt really bad. But, yeah, if you're going to lose that way to one of your homies and he's on his way to a Worlds invite and you have to win the tournament to get yours, you don't feel really bad. Like, I mean, it did feel kind of bad that my deck just, like, fell apart at that game, but that's all right. Like, congrats to my man Heggie for getting his Worlds invite. Not at all upset about that. And then we get to round eight, and this is where it gets interesting. So round eight, I play against Frostmoth, Water, and Inteleon Box. And round one, I have a pretty slow start. I can't just chain knockouts on his Inteleon or his Frostmoth. And honestly, I probably should have scooped that game a lot earlier than I did. Maybe not. I can't remember. I was still in the game. Like, we were trading prizes over and over again. I thought I was fine. But I didn't respect how slow that deck set up. I know that. I should have just let it ride. Because game two, we get into game two, and we finally get the setup. Like, we go first. I think we went first all games. We get the setup where we can start boss KOing up his Frostmoss. And this is going to, when I start telling you guys changes, this is the game where I realized I should have made the changes or the thought, or I should have upped the list to where I wanted it to be, like I was talking about with one of my teammates right before the tournament, but I did not. And we'll get to that in a minute. But we couldn't chain knockouts on the Frostmoth, the game one. Game two, we could. and he scoops it up. We go to game three, and this game goes to time, and we both agree that whoever has the most prizes at the end of it gets the win, right? So we get to time, and it's turn three, and we're both at three prizes. So there's literally nothing we could do. I ultimately just gave it to him just because he needed it more than me. I probably should have just took the tie, but like, even if I get like 60 points, like that knocked me out of day two, right? If I wasn't day twoing, there's no point. Like, there's no point in me playing out because like, what's say, however many point, 80 points gonna get me 140? Like, I'm not getting my world's invite. So it's like, he was a lot closer to me, so I just let him have it. Which that one was really close. I feel like I could have squeaked that one out. He ultimately ended up playing the mirror. I drew Charlie Lockyer playing that same deck that Heggie was playing, and he completely waxed me round nine. So it was close. Like, it was really, really close. It was the closest I've ever tasted day two in my life. Like, I'm not making this video to make it to, you know, well, come on. We all know, like, if what's a deck list unless it's like, you know, talking about your day two performance, top 64, top 32. This video is more for the people who are just right there. You know what I'm saying? Just on the cusp. I think this list is great. Actually, let's just, before I go into a spiel, let's talk about the changes. This deck needed cross switchers all day, and my teammate Aaron Rucker and I were talking about putting cross switchers in here. And as you can see, Isaiah played cross switchers and got finals, Isaiah Bradley. And a lot of other top performers played cross switchers in their list. And like, things like playing against the Waterbox deck, I could have used cross switchers because I could play a supporter like Irida and do something else while also gusting. But I couldn't, I was always a piece too short to gust, it felt like, in matchups like that, or even the Flying Pikachu matchup. Having the cross switchers as a non-supporter, a gust effect as a non-supporter, was huge for this deck and for the weekend. And I didn't put it in there because your boy had a little too much fun Friday night when he got, or Thursday night when he got in, so that's okay. That's the biggest thing, like the cross. The Battle VIP pass would have been really nice just for setup purposes. I think if we could have just ultra consistent this list, like Isaiah Bradner did and stuff like that, it would have ran a lot smoother. But for the most part, as far as my play, I was not disappointed in it. Like, the only two matchups that felt really bad was against Ethan Heggie and Charlie Lockyer because they were playing Flying Pikachu and I couldn't set up fast enough, so I can't complain about those. But like I said, this video isn't for that, right? It's not for to sit here and talk about how I got top 32 or how I got top 16 or how I even day two'd. It's about the feeling after a tournament run like that, because I started 4-1-1 and I was going into round eight. There was two rounds left in the day. I was still in contention for day two. It came to turns on in round eight, right? So I was that close. And it's like, just because you don't hit the mark, right? Just because you don't get to the next level of the tournament, you didn't day two or nothing, there's nothing to feel sorry about. You know, there's nothing to sit here and hang your head low because you didn't get there. Now, that being said, of this past three tournaments I went to, it felt like that all those tournaments. So there's something that needs to happen to push me to the next level. And that goes for any player that plays in these tournaments, right? And that's the biggest teaching point I can give any player that's just picking up a Pokemon deck for the first time and wants to be competitive. Go to these tournaments. Feel that hunger that you want to excel to the next level. Like, get your tail handed to you and learn, soak up information, learn what you can do better, because everything is still experience gained leading into the next tournament. And I was walking, when I walked out of NAIC, I didn't feel like I wanted to take that big summer break that I was thinking about taking, that I didn't mention until just now. Like, I was thinking about pulling back. No, I wanted to dive back into Pokemon. I was motivated to do more, and I think that's how you need to do to carry your business if you want to excel at this game. It's like, consume as much information as possible, gain your experience. That way you can move forward in the tournament. I will break through. I will get to day two. And you best believe if you are at the tournament that I go day two, you are going to hear me scream. And I know that's just the tip of the iceberg of the big performances and stuff. But it's those steps, those levels, those goals. That's my biggest goal right now, is to make day two. Next, well, I guess if League Cups come back, winning a League Cup too. Because I've been to the finals of those things. I can't seem to win one. But for regionals and NAICs and stuff like that, I want to get to that next level and then eventually climb from there. And you just got to trust yourself and trust the deck that you chose. I felt really good all day with this list, and I know the flaws of it now, but it was a good list, and I don't regret anything that happened to that weekend. I'm not thinking to myself, oh my God, if I'd have just won round eight, we would have just been right there. Nah, none of that. Everything happens for a reason, and you just learn to live with it. But all in all, NAIC, incredible tournament. I learned a lot. It felt good to be in the running for the day two, almost the whole day. We just didn't quite get there, and we will. I will be back for more, and I hope you guys learned something from this video about how to approach tournaments leading in the future. If you didn't, let me know in the comment section down below. If you did, let me know in the comment section down below. If you were at the tournament, let me know how you did. I want to know. I want to know what you guys think. As far as the channel goes in the future, there's a lot of things changing as far as... I'll get to that in the podcast later on, but for now... That's all I got for you guys today. I hope you guys have a wonderful day. Wonderful 4th of July is coming up next week. Yeah. Okay. But anyway, have a wonderful week. We will catch you guys in the next one. Peace.